for those of you who wish to tune into which of the performances and which of the actors and actresses have won the award. This evening, we are delighted to welcome back to Delhi, Sammy by Pratap Sharma, presented by Primetime Theatre Company Productions, Bombay, and directed by Villette Dubey. Before we start, may I please request all of you to ensure that your mobile phones are on silent. And may I also please request that if you do need to take an emergency call, you do so outside the hall, and that includes saying hello outside the hall, not in the hall. Thank you all very much. Have a wonderful evening.
I am a shadow. The shadow of an actor.
Me too.
Shadow, actor, everything.
I'm a part of the ensemble that will depict the other characters. But that's how it is in real life, isn't it? One monumental figure looms out of events as though he came ready-made for history.
But all the other little fellows and fillies who may have shaped him, I remember only incidentally, as if they took their life just for and by that brief interaction.
I'm not complaining. Who am I to play Iago to his Othello?
I mean, there are lead roles and lead roles. Not all of us can have the big meaty parts.
Some have to live off the crumbs.
But the great thing about being an actor is that you cross all borders and boundaries.
You break through colour, creed, kitship, kinship, the whole jing-bang shoot.
And you get to really understand another person. You know, feel their conflicts and suffering.
Even the aches in their bones. I kid you not. For instance, Dada Abdullah could feel the arthritis beginning to clutch at his right knee. Oh, right here. And I can tell you, it's bloody painful. But the greatest change in Dada Abdullah's life was brought about unexpectedly by the juvenile behavior of that young fellow, Mohan. You see, I had employed him as my lawyer to iron out some trouble I was having with Tayyab, this cousin brother of mine. So I had to bring in this Johnny, this Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, all the way from India. But he gave me another kind of headache.
Mona, you must understand.
What's there to understand, Dada Abdullah? That magistrate was picking on me?
Yes.
Did you see the way he was staring at me?
Yes.
Then he asks me to take off my headdress. Now, what's wrong in wearing a turban in court? Nobody objects in India.
No, but this is not India, Mohan Bhai. This is Durban, Natal, South Africa. So why don't you see that, huh?
But he didn't object to your face.
Oh, that magistrate is a fool. He took me for an Arab trader and thought you were a mere laborer.
How did he conclude that I was a laborer? And why should he bully me for that?
Mohan Bhai, you don't know the first thing about these people. They live by generalities and swear by race. Race signifies everything to them. Anyone who wears a fez is an Arab. And all Arabs are traders.
But then a brown man who doesn't wear a fez is an Indian. A beast of burden.
Mohan Bhai, you have to use your wits to survive here, huh?
Well, I do not want to provoke any unnecessary insults, Dada. So, I will wear a hat instead.
In the name of Allah, no.
Why?
A hat would make you look like an Indian Christian waiter.
But there's nothing wrong in being mistaken for an
Christian.
Indian
Christian. Good heavens, Mohan Bhai. Look around you. The Christians behaving so abominably here. I tell you, we have nothing to do with these Indian Christians here. They are their waiters, they are monkeys, they are flunkies of the day. Why are you laughing, huh?
The way prejudice begets prejudice. Why? We must reclaim the Indian Christians as our own. We must stand together in the struggle.
But what struggle, Mohan Bhai?
Why? Struggle against prejudice, naturally.
Mohan Bhai, South Africa is bigger than you. And bigger than that is the British Empire to which we all are slaves. When we are unequal in our own country, how do we expect equal treatment in another colony, huh?
You may have a point there, Dada.
But Mohan Bhai, you don't worry about all this, huh? You just concentrate on my case.
Dada, I have a confession to make. You see, I do not have much experience in courts. Before coming here, I handled only one case in India. And in that case, when I stood up in court, the words wouldn't come. So I had to return my fees to the client.
Good heavens. And I'm suing my cousin brother £40,000.
May Allah look kindly on my misfortune.
Take your seat in the van compartment. First class is for whites only.
I have a first class ticket. There.
It's the van compartment for you, my man.
I showed you my first
class ticket. No, but outside.
1 minute.
Outside!
I showed you my first class ticket.
Get outside, damn coolie. Take your bag with you.
Dada.
So how was it? How was it in the transport?
Oh, terrible.
Did we lose the case?
Oh, is that what you're worried about?
What else should I be worried about, man? 40,000 pounds is not a small sum.
Ah, the case has been settled out of court.
Out of court?
Yes.
But now 40,000?
You shall have it.
All of it?
All of it.
Alhamdulillah. But how did you manage that? That Tayyab is a very cunning man, huh?
Simple. He saw that we had no desire to prosecute him.
But I sent you to take him to court.
But why fight in court when you can agree as friends?
But... Go on, bhai. You should have still taken something from Tayyab for yourself, huh? I know what it is. You're afraid you'd have to make a speech if the case went to court, huh?
Perhaps. But I did make a speech in Pretoria to the local Indian.
Yes. I read that in the papers. I was wondering what you were doing. Asking people to keep the kitchen clean or what it was.
Yes, you could say that. In fact, Dada, I held up the white people as an example. They're very civic-minded. I also asked the local Indians to form an association which could protest more effectively on their behalf.
Mohan bhai, show us what to do. If you think things are terrible in the Transvaal, then read this. Read on the third page.
They're denying the Indians the right to vote?
This is just the headlines, Mohan bhai. Do you see the justification they give?
The Asiatic comes of a species impregnated by an effete civilization. They think in a plane unknown to the European logic. What is this?
I used to clip out these items and send to friends in India as a joke, Mohan bhai. But this, how can they imagine the way we are treated
here? This is a crown colony. Her Majesty Queen Victoria treats all her subjects equally.
British law guarantees equality. But you are gullible, Mohan bhai. The most unjust thing here is the law.
Then we must see to it that the law is not perverted. You see, Dada, I believe in the law.
What law?
The inner law.
What inner law?
There is a law higher than that dispensed in the courts. And when the law of the land is in conflict with that, it becomes a duty, to obey the dictates of conscience.
Mohan bhai, you cannot leave us now.
Huh? Why don't you bring your wife and children here? They can come back free on my new ship. Huh?
Yep.
Oh. All right, I'll get my family here, but only for a while. Huh? And Dada, don't be idle when I'm away. Huh? Huh? Organize the Indians. Huh? As of now, we have set up the Natal Indian Congress. Sign on every man and woman you know.
Huh. Women too? Of course, women. But Mohan bhai, surely you don't want me to go to the laborers. They have lost all spirit. They are no better than slaves.
Dada, people always have spirit. It may be hiding somewhere, waiting for the just cause and the right moment. Huh? And don't forget the Christians.
The Christians? But they are under the thumbs of the white clergymen who take the orders from the
Sign
government.
Sign them all. Hindus, Muslims, Christians, Jews, Parsis, all of them. And any white person who wishes to join us.
White person? But then he'll come and attend our meetings, Mohan bhai.
We have nothing to hide. Our meetings will be public and open to all. We are reformers, not rebels. Hmm? At the end of every meeting, we shall all stand up and sing, God save the Queen!
You're not serious.
I am.
You're naive, Mohan bhai. Naive. Naive.
You know, Dada, there is one thing I like about the white people is their sense of hygiene. They never throw papers in their dry.
Of course. Where's that rubbish bin?
Come back, Gandhi! Gandhi, go back! Go back to India!
Go back, Sammy! I will screw your balls off! Screw you, Sammy! Screw you!
Hey, it is him! He's coming ashore in broad daylight! The sick of the swine! Where's his wife? He's only got his wife from India.
And two children! Oh, he's coming!
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Afternoon, Mrs. Alexander.
Daddy's coming down the road. They'll kill him.
Yes, ma'am.
I better call my husband.
That's the superintendent's wife. She's calling the police.
They'll be too late. Let's get him ourselves. They're always chasing. Sammy! We passed that.
We're tired, are we? We're swimming.
Yeah!
Prejudice is a many-limbed, blindfolded tyrant. These are all the slaves of prejudice. This is the violent army of the tyrant prejudice.
But why are they violent with me?
Because they are afraid of you.
Of me? But I don't mean them any harm.
You would destroy the vicious God enshrined in their mind.
Vicious cannot be God.
You see how you think?
God is good.
If good succeeds, God is good. If evil succeeds, God is evil. So my concern is not with God, as God may turn out to be, but with the truth, because the truth is God.
The battle you talk of is too much for me. I'm not a fighter. I don't have guns to match their...
You need guns to fight a blindfolded tyrant? The tyrant himself is a victim of his own fear.
We have no power, no authority, no skill. Only the will to fight.
Spirit is enough.
Oh, these figures of speech.
Spirit is everything.
Only in philosophy.
You separate that from life? Then life and God are two things to you? Then spirit and action exist in two separate spheres?
You know, you talk like a Buddha. But how can an ordinary person like me tackle
these things? These are ordinary human beings too. Remember that. Reach out to them.
Remove their blindfolds. They will see. They will be ashamed.
But how? How? How?
They called you Sammy.
Do you know what the word Sammy means?
Of course. Most of my indentured labor on the plantations come from India, mainly South India. And their names end in Sammy. Ramasami,
Naransami,
and so on.
No. The word is Swami. Surely, Mr. Gandhi, that's not important in a time like this.
But it is
very, because it means master or teacher.
Thank you, gentlemen. I shall endeavor to live up to that.
I won't stand this nonsense in my house. Equality must be enshrined in the heart.
What have I done wrong?
You don't have to do it like a chore. You could take joy in the voluntary performance of an unselfish task. You could smile.
Smile? I am made to carry the urine of all who come here. Indian, African, European. But how can I smile when I'm made to wash the chamber pot of an untouchable? What will ever wipe away the degradation? How will I ever be cured?
By the very act! You shall lift up the untouchable and wipe away the blood from your past thought and action.
You will ruin us, the whole family. Are your children are being educated to be sweepers? It wrenches at my heart to see them working with brooms. Why can't they go to a proper school?
Schools teach all wrong values. I would rather teach them myself. Yes. Even if the only time they get with me is a 5-mile walk every morning to my office.
There you are. You see, you don't have the time. Engage tutors who could come to the house or even live here.
Parents are the best teachers. Parental example is better than any textbook.
And if they long for the school...
Don't you influence other boys! I know it was you who encouraged the eldest one to break with me. You sent Harilal off to school in India? Huh? I will not have this, you understand?
You don't have any real love for us. You even returned the presents we were given.
Why should you complain if I did that? It is wrong to take gifts for public work. Such service is not done for material reward.
Hey, Bhagwan, have you no sense of family? Are we to end up bhikaris then, huh? When my sons get married, are their wives to receive no jewelry from me? Honey, I simply point out our duty and you call it temptation. Oh, you are good to the whole world, but hard on your own flesh and
Kasturi.
Blood. Kasturi! See how you deprived Harilal of that scholarship. Harry, he dreamed of going to England and becoming a barrister. He studied hard to prove himself. But then you said it would be wrong from someone in our family to get it, even if he deserved it.
Yes, it would have been nepotism. I was judging the applicants. I couldn't choose my own son over others.
Harry, but even if he deserved it...
Even so, people won't understand. They would say Gandhi's son is being chosen.
People. So we are sacrificed to your public image.
Nasty jab. That's a nasty jab, woman.
Stop it! Stop it! Be sensible! Why don't I go? Your wife! South Africa has changed.
Every man must learn and develop and change.
First it was all Jesus. Whatever the white men say, you listen.
Yes, if what they say is right, I listen to all of them, but I decide for myself.
Please, don't make your public speeches at me.
Think before you speak, woman!
I am thinking. Not perhaps with those fake books like you do. And now you are learning the Bhagavad Gita by heart, huh? Chanting verses every morning. Shuka!
You tell me why.
Because you met this Jiso.
Theosophists.
Aye, Europeans trying to become Hindus.
Huh? Even if that was so, what's wrong with that? Mustn't talk nonsense, Kasturi.
Then why don't you ask all of them to come and live here, huh? You'd better be able to explain the glories of your religion, but don't let them see you misuse it at all.
I misuse it! Woman, Hinduism is rotting because of blind actions of people like you.
Oh, so now you are going to say Hinduism as well, eh? Along with me and everybody and India and the whole world, okay? Maaf karjo. I didn't mean to be rude.
Arey, you know I am a stupid woman. I can't even read and write. Maybe if I could, I could follow what you are saying.
Shut up. Every word you say wounds me to the heart. It is I who should have taught you to read and write instead of just lusting for you.
Is that lusting? Honey, isn't it?
What?
Love. I am too stupid to know. I must try and understand you.
Kasturi, have patience with me. And God give me patience too. We hurt each other too much. Even when you speak with pride about all this, this big house, the money I'm earning, the public work I'm doing, I'm thinking, am I doing enough? How can I live in a big house like this when people like Balasubramaniam starve and struggle? Huh? How can you sit in a suit and discuss religion and philosophy while they're beaten bloody by their masters? Surely religion is the right action. But what is the right action?
Well, certainly not this. But I will do as you say. I am tired of arguing with you. It exhausts me.
You'll soon have respite from me.
Hey, Prabhu, only when I die.
No. You don't have to wait that long. I'm going away for a while. Yes, I'm forming an ambulance brigade to look after the wounded in the Zulu rebellion that is going on. Ah, you can have peace while I go away.
I just asked for Sergeant Major Gandhi at the camp, and they pointed this way.
Well, I won't remain a Sergeant Major too long, Henry. They're disbanding the ambulance corps in a couple of days. This is no rebellion, Henry. This is a manhunt. Poor Zulus are being decimated.
Mr. Gandhi, if you're busy, I could call later. Thank you so much. Mr. Gandhi, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you in your work. I hope I'm not disturbing you.
No, Henry. You cannot disturb me half as much as my own thoughts and the sights I'm seeing. Come, sit with me.
I just came to tell you that the big house in Johannesburg has been given up as you wished. Kasturba and the children are at the Phoenix settlement. In fact, I'm on my way there myself right now.
Good, Henry, good.
Henry, I've come to you.
Oh!
What about? Like, that sounds like a huge decision.
We are to progress beyond the pale of violence, then we must purify us.
It is our passions which cloud our vision and lead to violence.
Oh, of course.
So you agree?
Mr. Gandhi, ever since we met in that vegetarian restaurant 2 years ago in London, I have found no cause whatsoever to disagree with you. Because what you take is always rational and has moral validity. In fact, I'm glad I gave up my job in England and came here to run your press. I even married because you suggested it. Poor Millie had been waiting for years. She's very grateful to you, you know.
And Nikolai, it is our passions which make us jealous husbands. Angry and violent with our wives. It is our passion which prevents us from concentrating on our work.
I dare say.
You see, lust for my wife would have made me rush back to her, abandoning the sick and the wounded, and I...
I know, Henry, it embarrasses you that I speak like this, but you know, I've always believed it is better to be frank. Otherwise, the truth slips away like this.
Oh, absolutely. Any man cannot indulge the flesh if he wishes to hone his spirit.
Therefore, I have decided to take a vow of celibacy. What we in India call Brahmacharya.
Swami, would you please write that word down for me?
Yes, of course. The word is Brahma Charya.
Mr. Gandhi, I must sound it. It will be hard, Henry. It will be difficult. But man is man, not a beast, because he is capable of self-restraint. The more self-restraint he exercises, the closer he gets to self-realization.
Oh, startling. But in line with the highest religious thinking.
Now, then, Nikolai, I do not expect you to follow me on this path immediately. Huh?
Our co-workers at Phoenix will discuss it and debate it. But I'm quite sure most of them will take the bow.
Have you discussed this with your wife?
Kastubane, other ideas or reservations?
Henry, you right. This cannot be a unilateral decision. You know, I've often failed to carry my convictions to Kastubane.
I'm quite sure she'll fall in line as she usually does.
But how does one go about it, this domestic Brahmacharya?
Stop sharing the same bed with your wife. And try never to be alone with her.
Well, I'd better be on my way to Phoenix.
Yes, yes.
Oh, I almost forgot. I brought you this book.
The kingdom of God is given us by you, Tolstoy. Thank you, Hindi. I will change the
hero. Mohan bhai! Mohanbhai, the government has passed a law requiring every Indian to be fingerprinted and carry a pass at all times.
What?
Read.
We will resist.
But how, Mohanbhai?
We will find a way.
Hindi, could you please go to Dada Abdullah Natal Indian Congress and ask him to organize a public meeting of all Indians?
Oh.
All of them. Say that I shall address the meeting. Oh. He can fit the time and venue.
All right.
Mohanbhai, how do you think this will work?
God will show us the way.
Ladies and gentlemen of the European Association, I now call upon General Jan Christian Smuts to give us an assurance that the validity of the law will be upheld.
Slimiani, could we please have a few words from you?
None of you need have any fears on that score. As head of the government, I have today issued orders for the arrest of all Indians who refuse to register themselves, including the foolish Mr. Gandhi.
Leave me alone, woman. Let me think this through.
Arey, what is there to think? You're going to land everybody in jail like common criminals.
That is the point. They are not common criminals.
Huh? So?
So, it will make an ass of the law.
It is more likely it will make asses of you. You will all be branded as jailbirds. And you will not be allowed to practice at the bar.
General Smuts will understand the point we are making.
Lo bolo, he will understand. But you cannot explain it to your own wife.
He's a barrister, like me. He knows that a man of law will not turn frivolously to breaking it.
And I am an uneducated, illiterate woman, too stupid to follow your reasoning.
I didn't say that, Kasturi.
But you meant it.
Kasturi, for heaven's sake, let me think this through. I promise I'll make it as clear as daylight to you.
Thik che. Since you promised.
Thank you.
Maravala.
Kasturi, we mustn't be alone together like this. You see how all these intimacies begin? It could lead to anything.
Brahmachari ji, forgive me. But just make certain you work out how we are going to make a living if you are blacklisted from practicing at the bar.
Is that all you care about? Money.
Ha! Then it is high time you thought of it too. Arey, you cannot provide for yourself and your family, how are you going to provide for the masses?
Don't look so surprised. It is obvious. If you rouse them, you have to lead them. And if you lead them, you have to feed them.
You don't have to feed them. God will provide.
God, God, God. We cannot leave everything to God.
Indeed we can. Vast crowds followed Mahavir, Buddha, Jesus. They led men without worry.
Stop, stop. Stop quoting their example. I'm just mean. Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi. And Kasturi is right. Jesus did feed the multitudes.
Of course, but it was God who provided. Loaves, fish, baskets full of bread. Eh? In the Sermon on the Mount, remember, behold the lilies of the field. They care not for the morrow. They toil not, yet they grow. And the Gita says, do your duty without thought of reward.
All right. I'll give up my legal practice before I'm deprived of it. I will throw myself on the mercy of God. Let Kasturi cry and protest. I'm ready to put myself to the test.
It is not you who is being put to the test, but the principles expounded by Mahavir, Buddha, Jesus.
If there is virtue in non-violence, there must be strength in it.
Correct. If you turn the other cheek and allow yourself to be slapped again and again,
there must be power in the example.
No one before this has attempted to use individual moral force as a vehicle for group action. You are trying to turn personal ethics into political possibilities. You are forging a new weapon. You can change politics forever. Go now. Address them.
Filling up, sir. Indians are flocking to be arrested. They say they want to be in prison just like Gandhi.
They want to be in prison.
How can these timid Samis and coolies lose their fear of incarceration?
I think, sir, that they are moved by the example of Gandhi, who has come among them and made their struggle his own.
Come among them? Man, you're sounding half-baked and half-converted yourself.
Keep a hold on your faculties.
Yes, sir.
I go on.
They have begun to call the prison His Majesty's Hotel.
At least they have a sense of humor. Hey.
Gandhi actually recommends the prison diet and praises the rule that makes the prisoners eat their last meal before nightfall. He wants them to sleep on hard beds. It seems he genuinely loves the prison uniform, particularly the cap. He's encouraging his fellow prisoners to wear it like a badge of courage even when they leave the jail. They have begun calling it the Gandhi Cap.
Good heavens, Enoch. He's making a mockery of us.
Well then, let's make a mockery of him.
You see what they have done now, Kasturi? When they realized that they couldn't frighten us by depriving us of our liberty, they decided to wound us by denying us our dignity. The state has declared that all non-Christian marriages will be deemed invalid. It does not recognize heathen rites and ceremonies.
Arey, who cares what they think? They're ignorant people anyway. They don't know our tradition.
In addition to that, they have imposed a 3-pound poll tax on Asiatics and have banned their movements by prohibiting their entry into Transvaal. I'm at my wit's end. I don't know what to do.
Have your orange juice. That's what you should do. It will clear your brain. I have it ready in the kitchen.
Astounded, Kasturi. You don't realize the enormity of this. Orange juice.
They say every time a door shuts, 1,000 others open.
I don't think so. I'm at a dead end. Even Kasturi does not realize what I'm talking about.
Injustice is best fought by those most affected by it.
But this new legislation affects women and their children.
Help the women to understand the implications. Then let them and their babies fight non-violently for their rights.
What? Women and children?
Why not? Then let babies and children and women lead the protests.
But that's unheard of.
Let them hear of it now.
Kasturi! Kasturi!
Ravi, I was just bringing it. I knew you'd become impatient.
Yes, yes.
I had it ready.
Thank you. Now, listen to me carefully. Did you know we have been living in sin all these years? Eh? You're not my wife. You're my kept woman.
Hey, Bhagwan! This is ridiculous!
No! Not ridiculous! This is the law. According to it, our children are illegitimate and will be treated as bastards.
This is so stupid.
I knew you would think so, so I want you to do something about it.
Me? What can I do?
Lead the women and children in protest from Natal into Transvaal without permit.
You want me to leave? And you want women and children to come out on the street?
Yes. Men will follow, of course. Court arrest.
You want me to go to jail?
Why? Didn't Sita and Ram struggle together?
Arre Baba, they were divine beings. We are just mortals. And how will you survive on a jail diet?
Well, you could ask for a fruit diet.
No, bolo. They will just give me a fruit diet for the asking, no?
Perhaps not. You might have to fast unto death for that.
Achha. So first you want to send your wife to jail and then you want her to die.
Kasturi, if you die in jail, na, I shall always worship you as a goddess.
Jao.
You had Gandhi arrested 3 times in the last 4 days, and yet the march continues without him. You've got to find someone who has influence over him. Tell me, Adolf, who does he consult? Who guides him?
They say he gets it all from his inner voice. Maybe you should get yourself an inner voice too. But it certainly isn't just his conscience he consults. He strategizes.
Well, arresting him hasn't disheartened the others. They keep marching. We keep arresting the ones in front and the others, they keep marching. It's like we're facing something that drives people from within. It's astounding.
We could turn them into cannon fodder if they...
If they what?
Rioted? Kill the European?
No.
Suppose they hurt a European woman? Even chased her down the road? Frightened her?
Both damage. They won't. They won't riot. They won't lose their firmness of peace or whatever it is they call it.
It's most distressing.
Damn it. What do you mean the Indians are boycotting the commission? It's been set up to look into their grievances. I'm extending a hand to them.
They cannot ignore my offer.
They say they'd like the commission to have an Indian on it, or at any rate, a representative that they select.
Impossible! They can't dictate terms to us that Gandhi is not going to rub my nose in the dirt.
Shall I let him in, sir?
Who?
Mr. Gandhi, sir. He's waiting outside to see you.
For God's sake, show him in, man.
Hello, Mr. Gandhi. How nice to see you. Good God, man. What have you done to yourself?
I beg your pardon, gentlemen.
Where's your suit, man?
My suit?
Your suit. You always came here dressed in a suit. My God, you...
You look like one of those Hindu laborers.
Exactly. To show solidarity with their suffering.
Mr. Gandhi, you are rubbing salt into my wounds.
Your wounds, General, but no one has struck you or shot at you like your mounted police has done with our poor endangered laborers.
Yes, but you have inflicted a deeper injury on me by your peacefulness.
Ah, you're beginning to see that.
Please, Mr. Gandhi, please sit. You see, the problem is, Mr. Gandhi, you are a man of peace. Had you been otherwise, I would have dealt with you. Otherwise? But how can I go on harassing a peaceful man?
Yes. How can you kill a man who is voluntarily dead?
My soldiers want to see some reaction, some resistance from your lot.
If a lion on seeing a great hunter approach, lay down on his back and put his paws up, then the hunter would find it very difficult to kill that friendly and playful lion.
Mr. Gandhi, there is no joy for me in this hunt.
So you concede to all our demands?
Yes.
Wonderful, wonderful. I've got the 5 points listed here. First, allow the educated Indians their entry into Transvaal without permit. Also allow all marriages celebrated according to Hinduism, Islam.
Yes. I'm well aware of all the points. Thank you. Please, sit. Please.
Sir.
Place this before the commission for its approval.
Approval, sir?
You heard me. Approval. Complete and absolute.
Aye, aye, sir. Mr. Gandhi, congratulations on achieving an approval so complete and abject.
No, not abject. Absolute.
Of course, that's what I meant. Yelsman, with this task done, I shall now leave for India.
Well, I can't say that won't be a relief for all of us.
But first, my plan is to go to England to meet my mentor, Mr. Gokhale, whose experience will guide my actions in India where still greater tasks await me.
Well, I dread to think of the fate of any politician or administrator who might dare oppose you.
I'm just a channel for the truth, General. General Smart, in all these years of confrontation, we have come to know each other quite well. So as a token of my esteem, let me present you with a sample of my handiwork. No, don't worry, it is not a bomb. I do not believe in violence.
Yes, of course. Of course, yes. Sandals?
Yes. I made them with my own hands, in prison. It was a wonderful learning opportunity. It's good leather.
Yes, but I'm not worthy to stand in the shoes of so great a man.
Are you?
Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi?
I don't believe this. You're the great Gandhi, vanquisher of General Smuts. But you're a little man. A wee brown Mickey Mouse of a man.
And you must be the very voluble, very dramatic and very poetic Mrs. Sarojini Naidu.
I see Mr. Gokhale sent you a letter as well.
Your reputation precedes you, Mrs. Naidu. Who hasn't heard of the Nightingale of India?
Well, some people pronounce it differently and call me the naughty girl of India. I'm so glad you have a sense of humor. I couldn't have borne it if you were one of those dull, holy types.
Oh?
Mr. Gokhale sends his apologies. He's stuck in Paris. He's trying to get here, but the war has closed all frontiers and it's terribly difficult.
How unfortunate. Do sit down and join me for a bit of lunch.
But there's nothing to sit on.
I have my prison blanket.
I can see you need some poetry in your life. May I present you a book of my poems? I thought you might enjoy reading them.
Thank you. I'm sure I will.
What is this uncooked mess you're eating?
This is squashed tomatoes, groundnuts, dried bananas mixed with olive oil.
Ugh. What an awful concoction.
Yes, my wife would agree with that.
You've taken some sort of vow of poverty, haven't you? Gokhale was telling me.
Non-possession.
Look, if you're short of funds, I could lend you some. Or take you out for a meal.
Mrs. Naidu, in all my years of studying in England, I got quite acquainted with the so-called civilized penchant for elaborate meals served with great eclat. As a qualified barrister, I emerged quite able, at least to dine splendidly.
But?
No, but. I just prefer this.
Ah! Right.
You have children, Mrs. Naidu?
And a husband?
Naturally.
Not necessarily. Some people have the one without the other.
How many?
Husbands?
No. Children?
Four.
Good relationship?
With my husband?
No, with your children.
Well, they pummel me all over and climb into bed at 8 in the morning. And they fight over portions of me as if conquering a battleground.
So, they're well awake before you?
Of course. Little children always wake early.
But you do not wake up till about 8 o'clock?
Not a minute before. I'm their mummy, not their nanny.
Right.
Look here, Mr. Gandhi. If you're trying to imply that a good mother has to wake well before her children,
then
I'm afraid I don't quite agree with that.
I can quite picture the scene. Little children flocking around you, scrambling into the softness of your motherly affection. Now, what could be more maternal? Surely there is no greater love than this, Mrs. Naidu.
Mr. Gandhi, I suspect you are a very clever man. Perhaps even a great man. But not, I'm afraid, a great cook. Nevertheless, I shall join you in downing some of this uninspiring stuff.
Exactly. Food should inspire you to nothing. Would you like a clean bowl?
This one is not unclean to me. It's your bowl. I'd like to share it.
You know, Mrs. Naidu, if I were an untouchable, you would be breaking caste barriers.
And if I were a Muslim and we ate together like this, we could help foster Hindu-Muslim unity. Mm-hmm. I know you're as keen on that as I am.
Indeed.
Now, why are you laughing? Out with it.
I'm just thinking that you're quite a songbird. You're just one person, but you've brought in a great flurry and noise which fills this room.
I should be offended, but I know you are sincere. However, Mr. Gandhi, what you remark on as though it were a fault of mine is actually my forte. Words give me wings, and when I fly, I carry people with me.
Veritable Garuda. Yes. You can help fly India to freedom.
Freedom?
For
India, is that your aim?
Well, I could settle for dominion status like Canada or Australia. But if that is not forthcoming, then complete freedom.
But how?
Through satyagraha.
Mr. Gandhi, I know you succeeded in South Africa, but the British Empire circles the globe. The sun never sets on it. It is the strongest, greatest empire the world has ever known.
The sole force of satyagraha is the strongest, greatest weapon the world has ever known.
Mr. Gandhi, in a couple of days, I would like to hold a grand public reception in your honor. It would be a privilege to have you address the gathering.
Thank you.
You can step forth on English soil and unfurl the banner of India's freedom.
No, Mrs. Naidu. I've got no plans to do anything as grandiose as that. There is a war on. I will not take advantage of the British government's preoccupation. This is Britain's hour of need. In fact, I would like to appeal.
What are you hoping for? Another medal as in South Africa? Or knighthood? Sir Mohandas Karamchand?
Karamchand Gandhi, servant of empire.
Or a baronetcy. Something even the children can inherit.
Shut up!
Self-control, ahimsa, non-violence. On Tolstoy Farm, you lost your temper and you struck a mischievous boy.
Keep talking, Millicent.
So violence has its uses.
But participation in war can never be consistent with ahimsa.
You acknowledge that?
Yes, I do. I admit I'm doing this in order to improve our status through the British Empire.
You mean when the British government sees that you can't be ordered like a slave, but instead that you will serve voluntarily, that in recompense for that, you may be given greater freedom, even dominion status?
That is right.
Your naivete and gullibility are so ingrained in you, you have turned them into high philosophy.
Go on. Make me hate myself. Rob me of my confidence. I am what I am and I will face that.
Then face me. Face the facts. You are a coward. As a boy, you were afraid of ghosts, apparitions, things in the dark. So you have made fearlessness part of your creed.
If a man is lame, should he not use a stick? A vow helps.
You were so disgusted by the fact that your father was so highly sexed he had to get himself four wives. You yourself enjoyed sex so much you were lost in it with Kasturi, unmindful of the fact that your father lay dying in the next room calling out to you.
It's my eternal shame, I cannot face him, oh father!
So, now you blame not yourself, but your desire.
It offends me. I prefer Brahmacharya.
The child, you were a thief. You stole money for cigarettes.
Thou shalt not steal, the Bible says.
Non-stealing is now one of your 11 vows. You wanted to be wealthy.
I urge non-possession. Better to have nothing. No distraction from the path of purity.
You have been hiding yourself from yourself.
I shall state it all, write it all. Publish it. Truth shall set thee free.
And now this. Not even choosing the path of the conscientious objector, but helping in the pursuit of war.
I'm doing this as my duty towards the empire.
The truth of the matter is staring you in the face, but you will not see it. You know why you are setting up a medical corps. Not for the first time, for the third time. Because you wanted to be a doctor. Not with your mud packs and potions. A proper doctor.
Yes. I love nursing the sick, healing the wounded. I wanted to be a doctor.
But the family did not approve. You remember their words.
The Vaishnava should have nothing to do with dissection of dead bodies.
So you could not become a qualified doctor. But war provides a break with normalcy. A man can help by doing what he always wanted to do. But after the war, what will you do?
I shall take a vow of silence and travel in India for a year. And I shall speak out truthfully, without fear or favor.
Upset many people, but it gave us hope. Gandhiji,
Please come for our assistance. Gandhiji, ever since you came to India, I have been hearing about the Western.
Gandhiji!
Hi, Ram.
Yes? What can I do for you? Thank you. Thank you very much. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'm in a bit of a hurry.
Are you Sunira Gandhiji? Gandhiji, I have come to Lucknow all the way from Champaran only to meet you, Gandhiji. Gandhiji, thousands of peasants like me are suffering because we are forced to go indigo and then supply to the British.
What is indigo and where is Champaran?
Come with me. I'll come myself. I'm ready.
I don't have any time now, but tell me, what is indigo?
It is a plant used for making a vegetable dye. Okay, Gandhiji, within Kathia system, we have to grow that part of our land, whether we want it or not. We have to
do one thing. Ask Congress to pass a resolution offering sympathy.
Would you? Please.
You go to Kanpur.
Gandhiji, I have come to Kanpur to request you.
I have to go to my ashram in Ahmedabad.
Fine, Gandhiji. Namaste, ma'am. Umile ke Kanpur, Champaran le jana.
Yes, yes, yes. My schedule is very tight this
day. I know. You're supposed to go to Calcutta to meet Bhupen Babu, na?
That is right.
That is perfect.
For what?
For a trip to Champaran.
Maybe later.
What are you doing here in Bhupen Babu's office? I told him we would travel together to Champaran, so he let me stay.
I gave him my answer.
All right, how do we go to Champaran?
From Calcutta, we go to Patna. From Patna to Muzaffarpur. From Muzaffarpur to Motihari in Tehur. From Tehur to Bettya. Or Bettya to Bagal Mela Gao. Champaran.
Show us the way.
Gandhiji, I hope you don't mind.
How can I mind when you're so persistent and have so much of faith in my ability to help you?
No. Gandhiji, I hope you don't mind that first we travel by train and then by bullock cart and then finally by elephant.
Amazing. Absolutely amazing. He's sweeping across the countryside like a forest fire.
Not without reason, Jawahar. He works hard. These are case studies of the success of Satyagraha. Your father, Motilal ji, wants Congress to understand how carefully Gandhi works. In Champaran alone, he recorded 8,000 statements.
8,000? Good heavens. I mean, as a barrister myself, I know what that means. So he's both organized and otherworldly. What a combination. Oh, I'm sorry, my father's keeping you waiting. Shall I go see what's holding
you? No, please. I'm early.
I'm jolly glad I got back from my ride, Andy. Give me a chance to have a chat with you. And I'm so dying to find out more about this phenomenon.
Phenomenon?
M.K. Gandhi. I'm trying to decide whether I should argue with him or agree with him. You will join us for breakfast, won't you?
No, thank you. I've already eaten. I used to get up lazily by 8 and eat by 9, but Gandhi's changed all that. Once nice remark from him, and I'm a different creature. That's his forte, changing people.
Well, I'd better watch out then.
Oh, he'll change you, Jawahar. Whether you agree with him or not. I'm told young English officers newly appointed in India are warned. Stay away from Gandhi or he'll get you.
Well, he certainly got the peasants of India.
They've begun to refer to him as a Babu. And Rabindranath Tagore is hailed as a Mahatma.
Mahatma Gandhi. You know, Jawahar, the other day a friend said to me, it is only India that knows how to honor greatness in rags. It's true. That is a homage that emperors cannot buy.
Stop!
4 years of the war, I had been a recruiting agent for the British. I had crunched the countryside, asking India to offer all its able-bodied sons as sacrifice in defense of the empire. I had expected that in return for millions readily given to protect Britain, India would, on the successful conclusion of the war, be given dominion status. But no such thing has happened. In fact, repression has been reinforced by the newly passed Rowland Act. Indians will be tried without jury, suspects jailed without trial. The implications are catastrophic. I've spent many sleepless nights wondering what steps to take, which would non-violently indicate to the government our determination not to be taken for granted.
Go on.
Tell them how troubled you are.
If they derive their strength from you, you derive your strength from them.
Deeply troubled.
You searched everywhere for a way to search within.
Searched within.
And then suddenly in a flash.
Suddenly in a flash.
You realize
what must be done. I was sick with worry lying in bed. In a moment between waking and sleeping, an inner voice said to me,
on a chosen day, let the whole nation come to a standstill to demonstrate
that the will of the people is greater than the might of the government. Let us observe a nationwide satyagraha in absolute peace, quiet, and prayer.
Governor of Punjab allowed the police to fire on a peaceful procession. Carrying its dead, the crowd went on a rampage. It attacked 2 railway stations and a bank. It killed 5 Europeans and beat up a lady called Mrs. Sherwood.
That governor's a stupid man. What else could he expect? If you shoot at the innocent, they are bound to retaliate. It shows the people's resolve. Bapu, just give the clarion call and the whole nation will rise with you.
No. You're wrong to be pleased. It's a shame.
What are you saying,
Bapu? It's a shame. Each one of these deaths diminishes us. Revenge is bad. An eye for an eye will leave the whole world blind.
But Bapu, the police fired on the ground.
That is no excuse. We must first curb our own urge to violence and turn it into love, pure love for the opponent. I made a Himalaya blunder in thinking that people could practice non-cooperation without proper guidance in non-violence. No, I'm suspending Satyagraha immediately and undertaking a fast for 3 days as penance for my mistake.
But Bapu,
just go and inform everybody that the movement is suspended indefinitely. Just go.
Meeting. I'm writing to you from jail on behalf of Father and myself to say that you cannot stop now. If you do, it makes all our sacrifices useless. The movement is gathering momentum. This is the time to push ahead.
Not for me. Of freedom, one on the wings of violence. What freedom is that? For what we seek is freedom from violence.
Sarojini, have you read today's paper? The governor of Punjab allowed General Dyer and his troops to fire without warning into a peaceful crowd of 20,000 men, women and children in this enclosed public park.
Thank you.
car was trapped with no exit available to it. The troops, they continued firing for 10 minutes till their ammunition was exhausted. Of these, according to official estimates, more than 1,300 are seriously injured. 379 are dead. Strict curfew has been enforced all over the city, and no one is even allowed to go to the aid of the injured or to even carry away the dead.
Explain your methods. They seem more like morals than means for achieving a goal. Take, for example, your insistence on non-violence. People are getting impatient, Gandhiji. They've been saying for a long time that we should take up arms.
And I've been saying for an equally long time that we are wrong. Guns and bombs lead to terror, and terrorism is answered with more terror. It's a vicious cycle, Jawahar, which only creates fundamentalists and fanatics.
Yes, but these are not right-wing people I'm talking about. They all say, see what happened in Soviet Russia, an armed revolution. I tell them, if we had the weapons, we would use them. But since we don't, we might as well be non-violent.
No. Even if we have real weapons, we must be non-violent. Position of arms implies an element of fear. But non-violence is unadulterated fearlessness.
Yes, but to fight the British, don't
we? We are not fighting the British, Jawahar. It is not the British people who are ruling India. It is the modern civilization with its exploitative systems. Unfortunately, today there is nothing called Western or European civilization. Only the modern civilization, which is purely materialistic. Behind the guns of colonialism and imperialism is the system.
The Marxists call it capitalism.
Marxism is itself materialistic and therefore part of the same trap. The real freedom struggle is to be free of materialism.
Frankly, Gandhiji, your views seem to me to be completely unclear.
Then, why do you follow me?
Because your idealism moves me. Because I see it can do no harm to anyone. I haven't the heart to disillusion you. Besides, there seems nothing better on the horizon, so...
At least you are truthful. That is the first qualification for a satyagrahi. Okay.
What's the second?
Don't mind it. I know you have a terrible temper.
Just tantrums. I tend to be impatient. I can't abide fools.
Well, you will have to put up with me, yeah?
Everybody, let's
from the ashram. You won't believe it.
Tell me.
You see, politicians in England and America often get sore hands having to greet crowds of well-wishers. Fortunately, in India, we only do namaste. But when you're called a Mahatma, everybody falls at your feet.
Ma, you've been a bit claw and scratch at your feet.
Feet, legs, arms, everything. Walking through a crowd is like walking through a path of thorns and brambles.
The Minuendo.
Yes, yes.
They love
you. He was saying that you have a surprise for me.
That. Arey jao, he lifts the cover. It's a present from his friend.
Arey, what is it?
First, you and I thought it's some kind of wooden bicycle. What you have been thinking about for the past 10 years. At last, Ganga and Majumdar has found it in Saupadi's loft.
Sachanka! The peasant woman's friend, the poor man's source of income.
I knew you would be pleased.
Please, I am overjoyed. How does this work?
Nobody really knows.
Surely one of the weavers in the ashram should have some idea about
this. They all know how to weave cloth on a loom. Nobody knows how to spin yarn on a wheel.
What a tragedy, Ba. Here I'm trying to recover an old art for which India was famous. An art which was deliberately destroyed by the colonialists. You know, Ba, according to folklore, they cut up the thumb of the weavers in order to create a market for the mass-produced goods of Western industrialization.
Shukam.
I'm telling you. Here I'm trying to find a way for India's millions to once again be self-reliant. And we still have to depend on their mills for our threats. And the secret of the ancient spinning wheel is the salvation of India.
Bapu, you know what I am thinking?
What?
You have at last learned how to make good speeches.
Stop saying that knowing sneer, Jinnah. You should have realized all was living beyond you.
Not at all, dear fellow. I know exactly what you're all about, along with that sanctimonious mentor of yours. You're trying to be like him and grab the hearts of the masses, hmm?
I wish you wouldn't speak of him like that, you know. He's the most honest person I've ever met.
Really? Tell me, Jawahar.
Do you seriously mean the days of your Savile Row suits are over?
I mean, each time you walked into the bar library, some joker or the other remarks that his suits are tailored in London and laundered in Paris and made useless in India.
Now, you know, very well, the whole thing about laundering in Paris is a complete canard.
But you've got completely to the Bolsheviks, or should I say the monks. How on earth do you stand that rough cloth next to your skin?
Handmade, homespun khadis. I'm proud of it. Mm-hmm. I'm looking forward to the day I can spin yarn for it myself.
And I dare say, you'll wear that silly cap on your head for the rest of your life. The prison insignia rather than the school tie.
Gandhi has made prison the most exclusive school in the world.
Oh, well said, Jawahar. Seriously, I do feel many of Gandhi's actions are wrong. He's trying too hard to become a spokesman of the Muslims of India. He's leading India into a calamity.
That's a bit far-fetched. What on earth do you mean?
Gandhi, in order to get a hold of the emotions of the Muslims, has taken up this Khilafat movement as his own.
Yes, sir, what's wrong with that?
Don't you see, Jawahar? It is dangerous. This is a religious movement. Sooner or later, the mullahs will step in and the extremists will take over. No. To play with religion is to play with dynamite.
Tell me, Jinnah, how is all of this affecting you?
Badly. He frightens me. I've never been staunch or religious, and you know that, Jinnah. But the more of a Mahatma he becomes, the more of a Muslim I must be.
Oh,
to get you some tea or something. Sorry to catch you waiting, old chap, but I've got half your vestments on there, you see. Sir John Simon, Major Ashley, Burnham, etc., etc. It's not easy answering a whole gaggle of entries.
Are they very distressed, my lord, with all the demonstrations that are waiting them?
Distressed? Devastated, Clancy. In Lucknow, when we banned demonstrations in the streets, the protesters flew black kites with Simon Go Back on them.
Frankly, Lord Irwin, I don't blame them. The Simon Commission is a dud. It's here to interview Indians to see if they are fit for self-government. But among all the members, there's not one Indian.
Can't have that, old boy. These are all members of the British Parliament.
Well, it could have included Lord Sinha. He's an Indian and an MP. The commission is an eyewash. It's not surprising at all that the Indian politicians are so united in boycotting it.
So, what's your answer?
Create disunity among them.
Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful thought. Yes, but how?
I've got some dirt on Gandhi. I've got some dirt on everyone.
Gandhi makes diamonds out of his dirt. You can't blackmail him because he writes all about it himself in his paper, Young India, and you can't pressurize him except through his own conscience. The only time I've known him to back off is when he's shocked by the violence of his own followers. Anyway, what's the dirt you have on him?
Well, it's his son, really, the eldest one, Harry Lal. He goes to prostitutes, drinks, brawls.
Still, that's not a crime. It's quite common where I come from.
He's broken away from his father. Gandhi has practically disowned him and written to him publicly to mend his ways. Harry Lal has now turned Muslim.
Good heavens. That must have given good old Gandhi quite a turn. He must now begin with Hindu-Muslim unity in his own home. And Moti Lal, there, though, anything on him?
Well, he's been seen eating beef.
Come, Clancy, you're talking about something I do practically every day.
But it's different for him, Your Excellency. He's a Hindu. He could lose every election within the Congress and outside it if it came out.
That's it. I've got to go back in there and answer those blithering MPs. Have you any strategy to suggest?
I suggest, my lord, that we pit them all against each other.
Of course, of course. Divis et impera. But they just had an all-party convention to forge unity and national identity, and they've adopted this multi-lar there, report as a blueprint for India's constitution.
Tell Sir John Simon to back just two of them, Fazli and Ambedkar, and you will be able to control the rest. Of course, I'm only suggesting what Your Excellency already has in mind.
Of course, yes. Of course. And what have I on?
You wish to punch Jinnah to Fazli and Gandhi to Ambedkar.
And, will I bring them down?
No, but it might tame them to your will. Then the divided Muslims and the divided Hindus can be laid off against each other.
Thank you, Fazli. Thank you for this brilliant idea. Thank you for bringing to light this brilliant idea of mine. That advises me. Come back. Let me walk you to the door. Now, suppose I suggest to Sir John Simon that possibly you send to the
rejected the demand for a constitution and dominion status. It is all a trick to keep you talking endlessly. You are no nearer self-government than when you returned from South Africa. You're 15 years older, huh? You're 61 already.
I must act decisively.
Yes, act, not talk.
But what action?
Something simple, direct, forceful that unites the country behind you. At a sign from you, let the whole country erupt with civil disobedience.
We have tried selling bad literature.
To intellectuals. The peasants must wake. The nation masses must join in.
We are thinking of breaking the revenue laws.
No, 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 no. That is all very well for the propertied and the wealthy. But what about the oppressed? Those who have nothing but bread and salt and water. Let the masses join you in a massive upheaval.
We need a law to breathe. There is no law against baking one's own bread. And water is for free.
But salt is not. Though it is found in nature, it is taxed. You have to buy it from a licensed government source. So a poor person has to pay a tax on what he can make himself.
So, what should I do?
Break the salt law momentously and let the whole country join in. Of course, you must let the Viceroy Lord Irwin have a chance to repeal the salt law. That is only fair. Write him a letter.
Travels in Africa, eh? I heard your mission was a great success.
Thanks to the renown of the little wizard. Do you know that's how they think of him? The little wizard who defeated the demon of racial discrimination. What are you doing? Don't you know the great march has begun? The papers are full of it. I thought we might discuss what we have to do next.
I am doing what I have to do next.
You mean you're trying
to... I finally found a book that explains how you manufacture salt. You either find it in my niche or you take some salt water.
That's hilarious.
No, it isn't. And I finally managed to learn how to swim. Look, there's my quota of yarn for the day. And now I find that in order to be free, I must also make salt.
We're all caught in the web of love spun by the mystic spinner. I'm impressed. Most of all, Jawahar, I'm impressed at how much he's changed you. I first heard of you in England as Joe. Someone said to me, must meet young Joe Nero, terrific chap.
Yes, that must have been about the same time someone said to me, you know, you must read Sarah Naidu's poetry. She writes divinely. I'd heard of Sarojini Naidu, but I was damned if I was going to read Sarah.
So we admit, it was Sammy who gave us the confidence to be ourselves. Our beautiful selves.
Easy, easy, let's not get narcissistic. We're still finding ourselves. Who's Sammy?
Narcissistic master, the Mickey Mouse Mahatma.
I wish that you wouldn't speak of him like that, you know.
Oh, and you're the one against all the awards and titles
and accolades. All this alliteration jars on me. Mystic master, Mickey Mouse Mahatma. I'm told you sometimes refer to him as the spiritual spinning spider. Define yourself as the woeful, wishful wanderer.
I'm not really offended. I'm just pretending.
Isn't it amazing, Sarojini? Bapu decides on a pinch of salt to shake an empire, but adds the drama of a 240-mile walk.
240 miles, 10 miles a day, 24 days. Mm. By then, the world will be waiting for that pinch of salt.
Does he get this instinct for theatre?
I always tease him, Jawahar, that it costs a lot to keep him poor. I think he is the greatest wonder of the world. And I'm going to join him and Dandi for that historic moment.
Sorry to have called so early, sir, but I thought this was important. We've just had news that the sword picked up by Gandhi from the beach was auctioned for 1,600 rupees.
Damn it!
People are now not only making sword, but buying and selling it!
Arrest the buyers! Arrest the sellers!
We won't have enough handcuffs, sir!
Use rope! Dealing in sword is illegal! So is its manufacture! Arrest them all! Indian cooperators are resigning from the Legislative Assembly. Indian officials are quitting the civil service. I can't be worrying about any damn petty offender selling salt.
Exactly, sir.
That's why I wondered whether we should let this dispatch from Webb Miller go through.
Who?
He is American.
What are the damn Americans doing here?
He is a foreign correspondent for the United Press. He actually made his way to the salt pans at Dharasna, and this is an eyewitness account of what he saw there. That's where the Indians went at the damn
day. I thought we arrested Kandri to prevent that.
We did, sir, but this time it was Sarojini Naidu who left them there.
Oh, breakfast. Care to join me?
I've eaten, sir.
Tea?
No, thank you.
You see? That's one of the problems facing a viceroy. Finding the time to eat between all the crises affecting an administration.
Shall I leave it on your table, sir?
Oh, what is that? No, no. Read it to me while I eat. Can't delay a decision where the Americans are involved. They have no patience.
Well, this is what it says. 400 men of police, commanded by half a dozen British officials, stood ready by the salt pans. Suddenly, at a word of command, scores of native police rushed upon the advancing marchers and rained blows on their heads with their steel-shod lattes. Not one of the marchers even raised an arm to fend off the blows. They went down like ten pins. From where I stood, I heard the sickening whacks of clubs of unprotected skulls. In 2 or 3 minutes, the ground was quilted with bodies. Great patches of blood widened on their throats.
Enough. God bless you. I can't believe you're doing this. Sir, this is what Gandhi meant by preparing the people for nonviolence. I've got to find a way to lift the ban on the Congress Working Committee and hold talks with Gandhi. Damn it. Absolutely ruined my breakfast. I'm so glad we can agree at last. Nearly 100,000 prisoners will be released. You will call up your civil disobedience movement, and Congress will participate in the roundtable conference in London. This is just what I've been praying for. You know, Mr. Gandhi, I pray every night, just as my mother taught me, kneeling by my bed.
It's always a joy when one's prayers are answered.
Yes, yes, of course. You know, one of the journalists called this a meeting of two saints.
That is new. Indeed. At least to me.
Yes, of course. Now, when you go to England to attend the roundtable conference, it would be a good idea for you to accept an invitation from His Majesty, the King Emperor, should he wish. Shall I say that you will?
When I'm in another man's country, I cannot be impolite to him. He's my host.
Good. That's all then. Mr. Gandhi, allow me to toast your health. The finest Indian tea.
Thank you. And allow me to toast your health in this excellent lime juice, flavored with a pinch of salt of my own illegal manufacture. It reminds me of the Boston Tea Party.
Unemployed. 300 million unemployed. How am I to talk of God to millions who have to go without 2 meals a day? God can only appear to them as bread and butter. Peasants of India were getting their bread from their soil. I offered them the spinning wheel in order they may get the butter. If today I stand in front of the British public in my loincloth, it's only because I come as the sole representative of those half-naked, half-starved, dumb millions.
Morning, Clancy.
Morning, Your Excellency. Gandhi is back in India, sir.
What's he up to now?
He says he's returned empty-handed because he was sent shopping with an unsigned cheque. He says you got him to go to the roundtable conference on a false hope, so he's decided to resume civil disobedience.
My God, he turns it on and off like a tap, doesn't he? Arrest them all. Immediately. Gandhi, Nehru, his wife, Sarojini Naidu, the lot.
Yes, sir.
And tell Gandhi bluntly that we don't consider him a representative of all Indians. He does not represent the Muslims. Neither does he represent the outcasts, the untouchables.
Right, sir.
He'll have plenty of time to read in jail. So back him with a copy of the new constitution as suggested by the Prime Minister, Ramsay MacDonald. It puts Gandhi in his place. And Clancy.
Sir.
Let me know how he responds, if he has any response.
Indeed. Now they seek by this document, this so-called draft constitution, to turn India into separate communal electorates and caste divisions. Here in Yerwada jail, I say to you, my brothers, as I said elsewhere before, that I am a baniya and my greed has no limit. It has always been my desire to talk of not only 210 million but 300 million Indians. Today, you may not accept that position of mine. But let me assure you that I have always spoken for Hindu-Muslim unity and removal of untouchability. So do not treat it as a grace of my old age. I am confident that God will grant me that position one day when I may speak for all of India. And if I have to die striving for that ideal, I shall achieve the peace of my heart.
Sir.
I'm
afraid so, sir. It's about Gandhi's response.
Well, he's in jail, isn't he? What can he do?
He's announced a fast unto death, sir.
Unto death? By Jove.
He says he wants caste Hindus to embrace untouchables and do away with untouchability.
Just like that. Overnight. Something that has existed for thousands of years. Something that cannot be erased by legislation. He wants to wipe out with one fast. It's like getting the Ku Klux Klan to embrace Negroes.
News of it is spreading like wildfire all over the country, sir.
If he dies, there'll be hell to pay.
It could be civil war.
He's got to be nursed in jail. Make him as comfortable as regulations allow. And transfer that woman. The poet is.
Sarojini Naidu.
Transfer him to the same jail, also transfer his wife there. That's it.
It is the 10th day of the fast, and you are weakening already. No longer so young, huh? All of India is worried for you. If they sign an understanding, will you save yourself?
If the Hindu mind is not ready to banish untouchability, root and branch, then it must sacrifice me without the slightest hesitation.
I'll give this to the Inspector General of Prison, so it can be announced.
This announcement will cause a great stir among the people. Already temple after temple are throwing open their doors to untouchables.
Harijan.
Yes, yes, Harijan, Harijan. Children of God, as you have chosen to call them. In Allahabad alone, 12 temples have welcomed Harijan. And soon more will follow. See, you may not make it all happen in a day or a week, but definitely you have changed an attitude by this path. No longer will there be social approval of untouchability. This is the most critical action of your life.
See. All right, thank you. Goodbye.
What plans it?
They've arrived at a settlement, my lord.
Thank heavens, thank heavens. Finally, after 13 days, did Ambedkar negotiate hard?
He's demanded compensation for compromises. The separate electorate has been eliminated. But Gandhi says he'll break his fast only after the cabinet in England agrees to all the changes he's made in the document.
My God, he's now dictating to the Prime Minister of Britain.
They've cabled the text to England and are now waiting for an answer.
Well, I think they've received their answer. And I'm glad they've received it direct rather than through the Viceroy. Shows that the center of power in India has shifted. And I'm glad the response to Gandhi's demands are positive. That's it. Sir, you and I had a little drink. Only if you are in control of yourself, can you be in control of the situation.
and merge your sorrows with larger concerns. We are now in the middle of a Second World War. Eh? This is no time to indulge yourself.
How can we be dragged into a war for the free world when we ourselves are not free? So the imperial government must quit India.
This is absurd. I don't agree with this. Lawyers have left their law courts. The administration is at a standstill. Thousands are being arrested and jailed.
The government is under great pressure. A Darbari regiment refused to fire on Satyagrahis. The freedom movement is like a giant wave sweeping across the entire country. And it doesn't matter at all that all its leaders are in jail.
Why are you stunned? Death inside prison is no different from death outside. And Kasturi has merely followed your secretary Mahadev Desai into the great beyond.
What will I do now?
Continue. Without as before.
Without blood.
Life is as much a part of death as death is a part of life.
But what is taking a long time to work? The blame of the funeral fire has dealt with it.
Well, you could go to your home and rest.
How can I leave her on her last moments on earth? She will not forgive me if I did that.
She was always looking for ways, to set you straight.
Yes, yes. Thank God we found the sari she loved.
He loved it because you spun it for her with your own hand.
Why, it got me with the red border. I called it her birthday sari.
It is burning along with her. That is the way of all matters.
I am so alone now.
Well, you have me.
Yes, yes. This is the very beginning of madmen and madmen.
That is correct. Look on the funny side of things.
Help me. Guide me to the right.
The means must be in consonance with the ends. If the end is to be good, then the means must be good.
Fight becomes difficult with each passing day. Prejudice masquerades as religion.
Not unexpected. You encouraged it.
Did I?
You made politics a numbers game. You encouraged large masses of people to take part in the struggle. Now nobody talks to each other except through the crowd.
Unfortunately, the Gandhiji now talks, have failed. The Simla conference has failed. The cabinet mission is here.
Let us at least form an interim government and get used to the idea of power.
Very well. If you allot some seats to the Muslim League.
Certainly, out of the 12 seats, we are leaving 2 to be filled by appointees of the Muslim League.
This is ridiculous. This does not give proportional representation to the Muslims of India.
But you don't represent all the Muslims of India. We've seen that in the pattern of all the elections since 1937.
Very well. What you now see is not some nimby-pimby civil disobedience, but direct action.
Jinnah, why don't you discuss this all with the new Viceroy, Lord Mountbatten?
I know where you get along with. The Mountbattens. Everyone knows, Jawahar. There are rumors.
What do you mean? Are you trying to imply?
I'm implying nothing, Jawahar. I know you well enough to imply nothing. All I'm telling you quite clearly is that Muslims of India should also have a home of their own.
Very well, let's discuss this sensibly then.
I think it's time now for direct action, Tim.
Jinnah.
Babu! Babu! Very bad news, Babu. Rahe se prakaran everywhere in Noakhali and Bihar, Hindus and Muslims are killing each other, Babu.
I shall come to Noakhali and then I shall come to Bihar. I shall walk the village road. I shall ask for peace.
You cannot go there.
Will you walk with me?
No, I can't. It is not safe.
Then I will walk alone. You know, the poet Tagore has written a song which I like very much. It says, if no one will walk with you, then walk alone.
Walk alone. Atla cholo. Atla cholo. Atla cholo re.
Atla cholo re. Jodi toro ta shuni tu.
There is no alternative to Fudge. There are two Muslim majority areas in India. One in the northeast and one in the northwest. These would constitute Pakistan.
We have waited too long for freedom to let it be postponed anymore. Even Sardar Patel says a government at odds with itself wouldn't work. Maybe it's better to let the Muslim League go its own way. Perhaps there is no alternative to partition.
But there is.
There is?
What do you mean, Babu?
What alternative can there be?
The unity of the country is at stake. This is no time for quibbling. After all, it's only about power and who heads the government, isn't it?
Well, obviously.
I suppose so.
Then I say let Jinnah form the government and let him do it. Why not? Why not? If Jinnah and his Muslim League are so scared of being swamped by the majority, then let them form the government and let them protect the values they hold dear. But don't partition the country. If you do that, you'll set up two armed camps in constant conflict.
Oh, have you gone mad? And then there are other problems too, like the princes and which side they each will take.
Sardar is talking to the princes. As for this, I say let Jinnah form the government.
You understand me, Babu, and you've spoken to Sardar Patel about all of this.
Yes, he thought it was a ridiculous idea. He said, beware Gandhiji, you're making yourself redundant.
Sometimes one can't help but agree with him. I'm sorry, Babu. We shall vote. You will be isolated.
Don't partition the country. I tell you, there will be a flood of blood.
Partition and be done with it. Jawahar, tell the British we agree. They should divide and quit.
We agree. Freedom at last.
Celebrate! What? Rights are broken out at the announcement of partition. Millions will be uprooted, rendered homeless. Caravans are being butchered, trade routes being massacred. I'm going to Calcutta and try and quell the riots there. This is not the independence I sought. No. This is not the independence I sought.
But the question is, whether it was possible or practical to act otherwise than what has been done. A division had to take place. There are sections of people on both sides who may not like it, who may not agree with it. But in my opinion, there was no other solution. And I'm sure future history will record its verdict in favor of it. Any idea of a united India would never have worked, and it would have led to a terrible disaster. Maybe that view's correct. Maybe it's not. That remains to be seen. Long live Pakistan!
At the stroke of the midnight hour, while the world sleeps, India shall awake to life and freedom!
Long live Pakistan!
Absolutely ruined by the most horrible rioting and bloodshed. You must have seen the parks and the pavements so choked with refugees. Those of them that suffer elsewhere come here to expect their help. It's terrible. What we need right now is the calm movement of Gandhiji and his prayer meetings. I beg for him to come and I hope he will.
He's on his way.
Thank heavens. You know, on top of everything, we're having a problem with Pakistan about the division of assets. They say we haven't given them all that we should, but dash it. We've given them their entire country, haven't we?
How much more is Jinnah asking for?
55 crores.
550 million rupees?
And we can't afford it. We just can't.
Where is it?
Here.
I need to be at it. Maybe just fire up a couple of rockets.
Hurry, I guess it's working properly. We'll just have to get closer to him, that's all. It's not difficult. He refuses to have any security around him. Go up to him, greet him. He's a Mahatma after all. Then take his blessings and shoot him.
Yes. He's a Mahatma. That's what we thought when we were young. But now we know that he's nothing but a hypocrite. The principle of non-violence is bogus. It's fine by the way, Muslims, butcher Hindus. But if a single Hindu retaliates, he sits on a fast to death. What sort of non-violence is this? Why didn't he fast at his partition? But no! He fasts for Pakistan's right over our money.
No. He needs to be stopped before he destroys my motherland.
Yes. Shoot that swine.
Thank you.
The light has gone out of our lives and there is darkness everywhere. The light has gone out, I said. And yet I was wrong. For that light which shone on this country was no ordinary light. That light which illuminated this country for these many years shall continue to illuminate for many, many more years. And 1,000 years later, it shall still be seen in this country. And the world will see it, and it will offer solace to innumerable hearts. For that light, it represented something more than just the immediate present. It represented the living. It represented the eternal truth.
Performance.